So this video is an overview of the Tesla Autonomy Day update, which was live streamed just a few days ago. There is a ton of amazing things that Tesla is doing really well. I think Tesla is a fantastic case study that demonstrates the potential of AI and machine learning. They also provide a fantastic example of how to develop a solid data strategy in order to develop a competitive business advantage. If you're new to this channel and you're keen to learn the latest tips, tricks, and tools for working more effectively with data, please hit the subscribe button for weekly videos. Now, Warren Buffett talks about how important it is to have a competitive moat to protect against competition. In this video, we're going to take a look at how Tesla implements a competitive advantage through vertical integration, domain expertise, proprietary technology with a high barrier to entry, and probably most importantly for this particular video in this audience here, is data. How do we utilize data to develop a competitive advantage, and how data can be utilized as an asset? Because there's a lot that's being said about this at the moment, but a lot of organizations aren't doing this properly. And this is really going to determine whether your data asset has any value or not. So definitely something that is worth understanding. Now, the first thing that Tesla talked about at this conference was their own proprietary chip design. Now, making your own microchips is a very, very specialized task. And there's very, very few people who have the expertise to be able to do this. So Tesla has also been very smart about the way that they've approached this by focusing in on a very specific problem. In this case, which is powering a self-driving car. Now, some of the key technologies that enable self-driving cars are computer vision, which is basically powered by a technology called deep learning and neural networks. Now, machine learning as a whole is very expensive in terms of computing resource. Originally, we had companies like Intel who made CPUs. These are general processing units, which weren't very fast for machine learning. Now, with the rise of machine learning, that's why we've had a massive rise in companies like NVIDIA, who make GPUs. Now, GPU stands for graphics processing unit, and these chips were basically originally developed for powering high-end computer games. Now, it just so happened that the type of calculations that were necessary for processing these computer games were also very, very good for processing machine learning algorithms. But again, these were not specialized chips. Deep learning is a very specialized niche within machine learning as a whole, and is also one of the most compute-intensive functions as well. Because of this, companies are starting to develop chips which are very specific to deep learning and neural networks. So you've got companies like Google. Now, Google's made technologies such as TensorFlow, which enables massive deep learning at scale. And so they've developed a unit called a TPU, which is short for Tensor Processing Unit, which helps to process all of these things much faster. Now, the thing to keep in mind here is that Google is a cloud-based company. Their focus is very much in having all this centralized processing power. They have a lot of things that they do in batch, and this is what the TPUs do very, very well. So Tesla talks about how Google's TPU has a batch size of 256 objects, which basically means you need 256 objects loaded into the system before it can start to process. Now, for a self-driving car, that's really not good enough because you want to lower the latency. You want stuff to be able to be processed immediately, straight away, in order to get real-time results. Now, to solve this problem, Tesla has built their own chip, again, dedicated to deep learning and neural networks, which has a batch size of 1. This minimizes latency and enables real-time applications. So right now, Tesla is focused entirely on powering a self-driving car. And it's really smart to have this dedicated focus so they can get really specialized in this particular field. You can imagine, though, that this particular technology is not just able to power self-driving cars. Any type of real-time processing required for something like computer vision, would benefit hugely from this type of technology. You can imagine any type of robotics, drones, planes, any of that type of thing would massively benefit from this type of technology as well. Now let's move on to the most important competitive advantage that I think Tesla has, and that is their data. Now, the reason I want to really drill in and dive into this is because this is the part that most businesses could learn from as well. Now, if you've been following machine learning or AI, you might have heard of Andrew Ng. Andrew Ng is one of the thought leaders in machine learning and AI. And one of the things he talks about is how these days it's very easy and quick to copy software. Any piece of software which is developed, it can be pretty much copied within a few weeks to a few months. And so it's not as much as a barrier to entry anymore as it used to be. But the thing that's really, really hard to copy is data, because anybody can go off and look at a feature and say, write a piece of software to replicate that. However, data is very, very hard to obtain. A lot of companies don't have that much data. And this is why he says that sometimes some of the larger companies actually have a competitive advantage in this way, because they have a lot more data than, say, something like a small startup who's able to move quickly, but they might not have the data able to empower their business. Now, if you are a startup, you have to start collecting data from somewhere. Now, this could be some open sources, which means that other businesses would have access to that same data, and so you don't have as much of a competitive advantage there. Or if you start collecting your own data, the trouble is that it takes a certain amount of time to build that up and develop it. And if it didn't take a lot of time to do it, then also other people could also collect that data and you would lose that competitive advantage also. So in a way, this is one of the advantages that larger organizations have. The problem that larger organizations have is that they have all of this data, but they don't exactly know what to do with it. The other thing is that at the point where some of this data was collected, they didn't necessarily think about how they would necessarily use that data. And this is one of the keys that will really determine the success of successful data projects versus unsuccessful data projects. And here's the thing that Tesla has done really, really well. So the first thing to mention is that Tesla has been collecting data for quite a while now. Since 2012, they've been collecting all this data from their cars for the very specific purpose of training their models to drive self-driving cars. Now, this is really, really important. The point here is that Tesla collected data for a very specific purpose. They knew what data they needed to collect, and they knew what format that data needed to be in order to power their models. Here's the thing, within a lot of organizations, even though a lot of data is being collected, it's not being collected for any specific purpose. And so a lot of times, a lot of the data required to answer a specific question is not available. Now, even if it is available, they don't really think about taking this data and popping it into some model to actually use for decision making. And so what happens is there's a lot of work required to get the data from its source state into the models that are required to use them. So here's the other thing that Tesla has done really, really well. Because they knew upfront what they needed to collect and where they needed to get it to, they've already developed these pipelines that get the data very, very efficiently from the cars and uploads them to their systems where they can use that to process that information. Now, organizations who get this wrong can easily spend thousands of times more on this data acquisition and data cleaning and data transitioning stage. If you talk to most data scientists, you'll know that usually 80-90% of their time is in things like data collection, data pre-processing, and feature engineering. If all of these things are thought about upfront, that eliminates 80-90% of the work that a data scientist needs to do before they even get to training a model. Now, all the results only come out once you start getting your data into the model and you can start seeing the results and tweaking it from there. So this is a huge, huge advantage. The other thing that's important to keep in mind is that once you get data into a model, well, there's a few things that need to happen. The data needs to be labeled, and you need to be able to validate the results as well that are coming out of your model. So Tesla has also been incredibly clever about the way that they do this. The actual drivers who drive Tesla's cars are constantly giving feedback to the system and training the models every time they drive. Now, Tesla has been collecting data since 2012. So that's 7 years of data, millions of miles of driving, all which has been fed back into the system to help train these models, which is absolutely incredible. There's a few other things I should mention here as well. All of this sensor data, which is collected by the car, the braking, the acceleration, the steering, the radar on the car, all of these additional sensors also help validate the models. They help validate what the computer is learning. So the machine learning models are going to make some recommendations based on all of the inputs. It's going to feed it back in a loop, and it's going to compare it against all the information that it collects from all of these other systems. And it does all of this automatically. So if you think about it, the other thing which is a huge amount of work is really validating the models, validating these results. And if you don't have some automated way of doing this, the way that like Tesla is doing it with their program here, that this starts to become a very impractical thing to do. Obviously, with a computer doing it, it does it automatically. If you had to have people to do this, it would take hundreds, if not thousands, of hours. Now, here's the next thing I think Tesla has done really, really well. What they've done is they've really thought about how to use these systems, not just how to train these models, how to drive a car, but then how you would roll that out into production. And what does that basically mean? Basically, what this means is that if you want to train a self-driving car, it's not enough just to have a self-driving car that works well in a simulation or on a prototype model of your car. You want a model that works on your end product, your end self-driving car. Now, a lot of times when businesses collect data, at first they use a very, very expensive method for collecting data. And sometimes this can kind of make sense because you think, well, I don't know what the value of this data is yet. Therefore, I will go out and collect this data, see if it makes sense, see if it has value, and then develop some project based off of that. Now, here's the potential problem that can happen when you do that. Sometimes, if that data is too expensive to collect, and there isn't a more efficient way of collecting that data, and that data turns out to be a key feature that drives your system, when you move into production, what you might find is that it's just not economically feasible to collect that data in order to run your systems. And then you can't actually use that feature anymore in production. So let me give you an example. Say that data is being collected manually, and there is no sensor or automatic data collection process that would even be available, even if you had the money to implement it. Some types of data collection, which are collected by people, just don't translate well to something being collected automatically. And anytime a person is involved in the data collection process, it instantly eliminates the ability to scale or put your application into production. Because it's fine a person doing one task one time, but if you need this in real time, if you need it to scale across thousands of data collection points, then having a person involved in any part of the process at all completely kills that. Now, here's the thing. A lot of times people don't realize is that it's just as fast, if not faster, to set up an automated data collection process in the first place, as opposed to some afterthought down the line. Now, this is something I think Tesla made a really interesting point about when they were talking about LiDAR. Now, for those of you who aren't familiar, LiDAR is a type of radar system which sends out all these little dots and collects the data back and builds up a 3D map of your environment. So LiDAR solves the problem of proximity. So you're driving a car, you want to make sure you basically don't crash into anything. Now, Elon has basically said that LiDAR is dumb. Now, he uses it for his space rockets and this kind of thing, but for a self-driving car, it's really not a great solution. One, it's really, really expensive and not a practical solution to deploy. And secondly, it doesn't collect as much data as you actually get from cameras. Here's the challenge though. If you're starting to build a self-driving car from scratch, well, it sort of makes sense to start with something like LiDAR because you instantly get all this proximity data straight away because that's the sensor data that's being read in. But ultimately, in order to drive a self-driving car, you need this element of computer vision because computer vision enables you to detect what different types of things are. Is this a bicycle? Is it a cat? Is it a plastic bag flying in the wind? All of these types of information are incredibly useful and give context to the system. Now, computer vision is also able to detect proximity, but it's a more complicated problem to solve. The thing is, once you solve this, you don't need LiDAR anymore. And this is one of the key points that Elon is pointing out. Because he started with computer vision and cameras in the first place from the beginning, all of these systems are trained very, very well to be able to do these types of things. 7 years of training data to be able to build up these extremely detailed 3D maps of your environment without having to use LiDAR at all. Now, it's possible that other companies which are using LiDAR, like Google, have also been using these to train their computer vision models as well. And I think that would be a logical, sensible approach. I mean, Tesla still has a radar system in their car, and this is used to validate the results produced by the computer vision. So again, this is these kind of cross-referential data points which can be used to train and test the results that the computer is returning. The problem is if you start with something like LiDAR, which gives you a lot of the data out of the box without having to train these models, then you may not have spent as much time and resource on training the models to work off the computer vision instead. And so this is a really, really interesting point. Are you collecting the data which is necessary to solve your specific problem? Secondly, how are you collecting your data? Is it being done in an automated way, or can it be done in an automated way? Thirdly, even if you are getting it done in an automated way, is it an automated way which would be cost-effective to put into production? Because if it's not, then that's still not a practical solution also. So I hope all of this information has given you an idea of why it's not enough just to go off and hire a data scientist and start collecting some data and training some models. You really have to think about this in a very strategic kind of way. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to extract the value out of this technology, which is really going to provide value to your business. If you want to find out more about how you can work more effectively with data and how you can start developing up a good data strategy, then you can get in touch with me at www.datastrategywithjonathan.com. If you liked this video, please leave a thumbs up. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.